Thank you, Professor Chaturvedi, and also Amit Agnihotri ji for giving me this opportunity to be here. I am standing to speak at a time, Chairperson, when this session is about to end. So I'm sure that there is going to be huge constraint of time with you. But quickly, a couple of points for your consideration. I think Professor Chaturvedi, Rajan Saxena ji, and Dr. Atmanand, they have already highlighted and presented a fairly good summary of about 500-page document of the National Education Policy. I would agree with Professor Chaturvedi that management education has not been dealt in the new education policy in as much depth as we would have expected it to. Just to be fair, there has been one member and belonging to the management discipline, and he has also been one of the most active members in the drafting committee, Dr. M.K. Sridhar, who is from the Canara Bank School of Management at the University of Bangalore. And I think a couple of other members also had some background in the educational administration. Presently, business education in our country is being organized in two forms. One is the standalone management institute, and the other one are those which are affiliated to the university system. And those of you who have been concerned that what happens to these standalone institutions after the IM Act, and whether you would still be offering the postgraduate diploma or would you be forced or compelled to get affiliated to university, this new education policy brings in a reprieve. They are talking about that this old affiliation system need to go. I mean, the affiliation system need to go because so far, presently, we had the policy that only the universities or maximum institution deemed to be universities could award degrees. All other institutions cannot award degrees unless they fall into these three categories. So now they are talking about that let us do away with the affiliation system. So if you are a higher educational institution, you are also empowered to award degrees. So that is something which is very positive development for the standalone institutions. What is threatening for you is that they are saying that of all the existing 50,000 colleges and standalone institutions, there would be a consolidation and these numbers are to be reduced to about 12 to 15,000. So there is going to be a lot of churning. There is going to be a lot of questions as to who exists and who wind up their shops. And from that point of view, if you look at the whole spirit of the new education policy, there are two, three focus, and it appears that only those institutions would survive who meets those kind of focus. One is that they are saying that all higher educational institutions have to be multidisciplinary to impart holistic higher education. And that also in context would also mean at different levels of higher education. So the challenge before us is standalone institutions is that how easy or difficult it would be for you to become multidisciplinary. What other programs, courses, discipline that you would be wanting to offer, and what would be the kind of synergy that those disciplines shall have. Second thing that they're talking about is that when every program of studies in every institution has to have a strong components of liberal art. Liberal art is an American connotation. It's not anything very new. But essentially, it also means that rather than just focusing on a super specialization, the students and the environment on the campuses are such that people are exposed to basic sciences, humanities, social sciences, languages, and some of the finer arts which are needed to become a holistic personality. To what extent would you be able to adopt this approach of liberal education? To me, it appears that management education by nature is liberal, so it should not be very difficult, but you may have to think of these things. Third thing, which is particularly true for private institutions, but also true to the public institutions, that throughout the policy, there is a thought, and this thought is that all institutions of higher education shall be similar and they will be reflective of public spiritedness. Now, they have not defined this public spiritedness, but applying the common dictionary meaning would mean that, of course, the profit motives has never been permitted, but any kind of cross-commercialization would not be there. The institution would work in the larger public interest. And therefore, a couple of points which Dr. Atmanand mentioned, that like our earlier speaker, about the board, the management, the basic philosophy which guides the decision-making process about admissions, about fees, etc. So it will also be a challenge, largely to a private sector, but also to a public sector, because increasingly many of public institutions have also started imbibing some of the characteristics of the private institutions. So those who have already imbibed some of the characteristics of the private institutions, they will have to move towards the public spiritedness. So this dilemma that you had about MDI would perhaps also be a dilemma about many other universities. Because if you look presently, most universities, public funded universities today, run management program in particular in a self-financed mode with no teacher, with high fees, all dependence on the guest faculty, and therefore they will also have to move towards the public spiritedness. There is also a barrier which we or you had so far is being removed, and that was the barrier of the price regulation. Because presently it was the content which was being regulated, the pedagogy which was being regulated, input being regulated, output being regulated, and additionally, the price was also being regulated. So the policy talks about the autonomous, but then this autonomy is also subject to certain controls. But in this process, what has come out emphatically is that there shall be no price regulation from the government. The institution, whether they are public or private, they would be free to charge any fees. That is, in fact, the language which is written. They will be free to charge any fees. The only condition that they have put in is that nearly half of the students would be provided liberal scholarships, fee waivers, and free ships. And they have also given a formula as to how would you decide that who will get this fee waiver and scholarship, that take the NSF data, find out that who are the people who are below the income, median income category, and then provide scholarships. Other than that, they are saying that you are free to charge any fees. And then linking this thing with equity, so far our approach in the country has been that equity and inclusiveness can be ensured through strong public supports and public investments. I'll have to read the report again, but when Professor Chaturvedi says that it talks about 6% of GDP or GNP, I did not find it. Rather, they have taken a different approach. They are saying a certain percentage of the government budget should be spent. And they are talking about 20% of the government budget that should be allocated for education. They are not making a reference of 6% of the GDP for this policy. They are referring it for the earlier commitment. So I do not think that there is going to be any, or we should be rather not very hopeful, of very substantive enhancement in the public funding. It is going to be that like private self-finance, high fees kind of institutions, which will survive and flourish. So the route to equity is only through scholarships. They are saying that institutions should be autonomous. They are talking about empowered board, autonomous board, taking all decisions. In fact, head of the institutions, even in public funded institutions, being appointed by the board. And I think by and large, that model has already come in the IM Act. So that model is going to be replicated. And then you have all the academic autonomy. You also have all the administrative autonomy. But then they are saying that this financial autonomy would be subject to your becoming self-dependent. Just concluding, sir. And therefore, it would be in the vested interest of the institutions to get complete autonomy that you also become self-dependent and least reliant. In conclusion, I would say that there are opportunities, but there are also challenges. Challenges are existential for quite a good number of business schools, given the quality, given the vacancy, given the inability to fill up their seats. And therefore, we had to focus on quality, whichever way you want to define quality, employability, placement, research, whatever way, whatever matrix you want to use. So quality has to be the focus. If you are able to focus on quality, you are able to not only survive, but also flourish and feel lesser barrier in the form of regulation. Will this new education policy be implemented in totality? I would like to keep my finger crossed. This is too bulky a document, too many ideas, and the governments, not only this government, governments have been known to pick and choose what suits to them. They adopt, they implement, and quite often, most of the things that they pick and choose are not necessarily the one which we thought were good. Personally, I'm very happy that I have been, and there are many others who have been writing, that quality of higher education is, in fact, inversely proportional to the intensity of regulation. And this seems to be hugely reflected in this new education policy when they are seeing free the educational institution from regulation. Provide them framework, trust them, they will perform. Thank you very much.